Next on Unsolved Mysteries. In 1947, a strange object crashed in Roswell, New Mexico. Did the government cover up an alien landing? A Marine is found shot to death in his own bed. Police say suicide. His parents say murder. She was close to getting a divorce, and then she went missing. What really happened to Dottie Caylor? And NFL legend Reggie White was the minister of a Tennessee church when someone burned it down. Can the arsonist still be caught?
Five cases with strange clues, bizarre twists, and with secrets you would never expect. I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries. In 1947, a mysterious craft was found on a ranch outside of Roswell, New Mexico. The government said that it was a weather balloon, but eyewitnesses say that it was a UFO. Roswell, New Mexico, location of the most famous UFO sighting of all time. In July 1947, a violent electrical storm swept over the desolate plains of South Central New Mexico. At his remote ranch house, Mac Brazel patiently waited out the lightning and thunder.
Mac was a old-time cowboy, I guess you'd say. He was pretty serious. If he told you something, you could pretty well depend on it.
The story is that Mac Brazel supposedly heard a loud crash at some point during the storm and didn't know if it was related to the storm or not. According to his son, Mac was on the range the next day looking to see which fields may have gotten precipitation the night before so they could move the livestock to those fields because the grass would be better there. And in his process of looking to see where the rain had come down, he found the debris field spread out near his ranch house.
Something had crashed in one of his fields the night before. But it was fragmented beyond identification.
The debris field was approximately 3/4 of a mile long, maybe as much as 200 or 300 feet in width. Scattered along there were bits and pieces of material. We refuse to call it metal because from the descriptions we have, it was more of a plastic-like material, very strong, very lightweight. Pieces of it were described as being 3 or 4 feet long, but as light as a feather, as thin as newsprint. There were metal beams that were slightly flexible, but very strong.
Some of the metal pieces appeared to have strange qualities and unusual tensile properties. They couldn't be cut, and they couldn't be burned. The following Monday, Brazel reported his discovery to the sheriff, who informed the nearby Roswell Army base. That afternoon, Mac Brazel led two Army intelligence officers to the crash site. One of the officers was Major Jesse Marcel Sr., whose primary duty was to investigate air accidents.
Why don't you just stay there, Mr. Brazel?
Even with his experience, Marcel was unable to identify the craft. He died in 1982, but before his death, he gave the following interview for a documentary film about UFOs.
There were just fragments strewn all over the area, an area about 3/4 mile long and several hundred feet wide. So we proceeded to pick up the parts. Says, I tried to bend the stuff. Says, it will not bend. I even tried to burn that. It would not burn. See, that stuff weighs nothing. It's not any thicker than tinfoil. Says, we even tried making a dent in it with a 16-pound sledgehammer. One thing I was certain of, being familiar with all air activities, that it was not a weather balloon, nor an aircraft, nor a missile. It was something else, which we didn't know what it was.
Major Marcel loaded his car with the unusual debris and drove back to Roswell. On his way, he stopped at home to show his family what he had found.
When he came back to the house, he had had a bunch of wreckage with him, and he brought the wreckage into the house, actually waking my mother and myself out so we could view this because it's so unusual. It's about 2 o'clock in the morning, and he spread it out so he could get some basic idea of what it looked like, what it was.
Jesse Marcel was 11 at the time. He is one of the few people known to have actually handled pieces of the debris.
The army plane crashed?
We were amazed by this debris that was there, primarily because we didn't know what it was, you know, just the unknown.
Look at this writing.
The most remarkable fragment was a short piece of I-beam, which was covered with strange symbols and markings.
Looks like some kind of hieroglyphics.
This writing could be described as Egyptian-type hieroglyphics, but not really. The symbols that were in the I-beams were more of a geometric-type configuration in various designs. It had a violet-purple-type color, and was actually an embossed part of the metal itself. Years after this incident happened, we would talk privately among ourselves about what the possibilities of this, what this thing was. And I feel that I know that we came to the conclusion it was not of earthly origin. If I had not actually held pieces of it in my hand, I would not think that it would be possible. But because I happened to see this, that's the only reason I believe it.
Major Marcel took the wreckage to the Roswell base where he was stationed. It's believed that the next morning, some of the pieces were flown to Wright Field, near Dayton, Ohio. On the way, the plane stopped at an air base in Fort Worth, Texas. That same morning, Colonel William Blanchard, the commanding officer in Roswell, went public with the story of Mac Brazel's discovery.
PIO's office, Lieutenant Hawk speaking.
Hawk, this is Colonel Blanchard.
Colonel Blanchard, yes, sir. What can I do for you, sir?
Colonel Blanchard ordered Lieutenant Walter Hott to issue a press release telling the country that the Army had found the wreckage of a flying saucer.
I never questioned it. In 1947, when a colonel told a first lieutenant to do something, the first lieutenant did that. There's a little bit of difference. You didn't have any democracy back in 1947 in the military establishment.
The press release read in part, "The many rumors regarding the flying disc became a reality yesterday when the intelligence office of the 509th Bomb Squadron was fortunate enough to gain possession of a disc through the cooperation of a local rancher." The press release was immediately picked up by newspapers across the country. The story created an uproar. That same day, an engineer for the Soil Conservation Service made another discovery. Barney Barnett of Socorro, New Mexico, died in 1969. He may have come across the first positive proof that there is other life in our universe.
Barney was just a real straightforward, just what you would call a real straight guy. He wouldn't tell you one story out of color or nothing. That's why I was really surprised when he related this information to me about the crash saucer. He told me that he'd come onto this spaceship. It was during the daytime. It was an oval shape. And it had crashed and it had broken open. There was four beings laying on the ground, not in the spaceship. They were scattered not too far from the object. He did describe that the heads were larger than the bodies by proportion. And they had some type of clothing on that looked a little bit different, not exactly like our space suits or that sort of thing.
Barney told Vern that he reached the crash site at about the same time as some archaeology students who had seen the wreckage from their nearby dig. The military also discovered the second crash site after an aerial search, but they arrived too late to secure the area.
Sergeant, get those people out of there and in front of this Jeep now.
Barney Barnett and the students had a clear and detailed look at the craft and its occupants.
When the Army showed up, they immediately escorted these people from the scene. And then at that time, they give them a warning not to relate any information to anybody. From that time on, Barney never mentioned it to anybody until the time that he told me about the thing.
The Barnett story has only been told secondhand, but many believe there is too much supporting evidence to completely dismiss it.
When he first told me, I was sort of flabbergasted. I didn't know what to say, but I believed it because of his integrity. He would never concoct any story. That's why I believe it to be true.
Next, we'll examine the possibility that the military not only removed the spacecraft, but that they purposely kept the news of this astounding discovery from the American people. On July 8, 1947, newspapers across America reported that a UFO crashed in New Mexico. That same day, debris and perhaps alien bodies were flown to an Air Force base in Fort Worth, Texas. And that, my friends, is when the official story began to change. Brigadier General Roger Ramey was a high-ranking Army Air Force official at Fort Worth. Within hours, Ramey's office issued a new press release stating that the material recovered in New Mexico was not a UFO, but in reality, the wreckage of a U.S. Army weather balloon.
My dad said obviously it was a cover-up story. It was not a weather balloon. He was a little disturbed about that, but he had his own security classifications to protect. He could not really go public with, hey, this is not a weather balloon. So he had to keep that to himself.
The UFO incident was still very much alive for Mac Brazel. At the time, a rumor surfaced that Mac was briefly detained at the Roswell base. Later, a man named Floyd Proctor saw Brazel, but Mac seemed scared to talk with his friend.
Floyd and a neighbor was in Roswell and saw Mac surrounded by some of the Air Force people. And they walked right by him, and Mac wouldn't speak to him. And Mac, he wouldn't talk about it after he come back home. He did say that if he ever found something else, he wouldn't report it.
By the time Mac was released, all traces of the Roswell crash had been removed from his ranch. The debris had been taken to Wright Field in Dayton, Ohio.
Everything went to Wright Field. That's where the Air Technical Intelligence Center was. That was where they could make the studies. Subsequent to that, we think that the material has been sent elsewhere. We think one of the bodies has gone to Langley, CIA headquarters. We think another has gone to MacDill, which is an Air Force base in Florida, where they have an aerospace medicine facility. We don't know where other stuff has gone. We think some of it is still left at Wright Field.
There was no real proof to dispute the Army's statement that the wreckage was a weather balloon. And then, more than 30 years later, UFO researchers obtained a document containing what they believed was new evidence. The MJ-12 memo had been mailed anonymously to a UFO researcher.
Operation Majestic 12, or MJ-12 as it's called, was a group of 12 people apparently established by the president to deal with the wreckage from Roswell and the whole problem that that created. How did these things work? Where did they come from? How can we get more information?
The contents of the report stunned researchers. In part, it read, "On 7 July 1947, a secret operation was begun to assure the recovery of the wreckage. Four small human-like beings had apparently ejected from the craft. All four were dead." Effective cover story. That the object had been a misguided weather balloon. The government has refused to comment on the MJ-12 memo or its origin. But if this document and other accounts from 1947 are true, then our government has evidence of alien life. Other than Barney Barnett, only one other man has ever admitted to having seen the aliens.
My husband, Oliver Henderson, otherwise known as Pappy in the Air Force, he was entrusted with many of this country's top secrets, and they were safe with him. He never told anything that he wasn't supposed to.
Captain Pappy Henderson piloted the plane that took the first pieces of the wreckage out of Roswell. In 1981, 2 years before he died, he told his wife that the Roswell incident really happened.
My husband told me the bodies were small, smaller than human bodies. The heads were larger, and the eyes were rather sunken and a little slanted. Clothing was of material unlike anything he'd seen before. They were strange. They were not of this earth.
For more than a half a century, the military has stuck by its story of a downed weather balloon. But the people who actually saw and touched the wreckage don't buy it. They believe that the mysterious craft and the creatures found nearby were nothing less than a visitation from another world. Next, a timid woman who is afraid to leave her house finally steps out and then vanishes. It was a warm summer day in Pleasant Hill, California. Jule Caylor drives his wife, Dottie, to their local BART station. She purchases a ticket, a simple task performed each day by millions of commuters. But for Dottie Caylor, it's a test of courage. Dottie suffers from agoraphobia, an irrational and overwhelming fear of being in public places. No one knows for sure if she actually boarded the train. Because since that day, there has been no trace of Dottie Caylor.
Oh, after the first few days, I thought that she had left temporarily to, simply make things inconvenient for me.
I think that Dottie could have disappeared to get even with her husband, who had disappeared on her for half of their married life.
At first, friends thought Dottie left to escape an unhappy marriage and start a new life in another city. But months and now years have gone by with no word from her. Today, people who knew Dottie wonder if she's even alive.
Dottie had what doctors have called agoraphobia. She would stay inside most of the time. She couldn't even apply for a job, much less hold one down. It was a real problem.
Dottie's condition strained her marriage to Jule to the point of violence.
She told me that they got in an argument. It escalated to the point where he finally hit her with a board or something, and she received a wound in her head, and that she did grab some scissors and said, "You keep away from me," and protected herself.
And she was standing over top of me with those scissors.
Jewel says that Dottie started the fight.
Swearing at me and saying, "I'll kill you. You son of a bitch, I'll kill you." And I grabbed her little typing stand and hit her with it.
Without ever telling Jewel, Dottie joined a support group called Women in Transition.
As time went on, I would notice she's adding a little more color to her outfits. She cut her hair in a new style, which was a very scary thing for her. It was as if a new Dottie were emerging.
In addition, Dottie secretly rented a post office box to receive her mail without Jewel knowing about it.
She had a secret existence that I knew nothing about. And she wanted it that way. I only began to become aware of it, near the time that she disappeared. I wasn't even aware of it. I was just suspicious.
Eventually, Dottie and Jewel Caylor agreed to divorce. 1 month before Dottie disappeared, Jewel accepted a job transfer to Salt Lake City.
Dottie had said, in the event that I got transferred, that she was not interested in going with me. So I wasn't expecting her to go with me, and wouldn't even have wanted her to, I guess.
According to Jewel, just a few days before he was to leave for Salt Lake City, he drove Dottie to the BART station.
I took her down to the BART station. She had with her a little overnight bag, and I dropped her off, and she walked around the corner of the station and disappeared.
Jewel is also sure that Dottie had her purse as well as her overnight bag when she walked into the station. But no one knows if she ever boarded the train. The next day, Jewel came home early from work. In the BART parking lot, he was surprised to find Dottie's Volkswagen parked next to his car.
So I walked over and looked inside, and then I noticed her purse, and that was very, very strange.
She told me how important it was to her to have her purse with her all the time. That's one of the things that made me feel so terribly upset when I realized that she had not taken her purse with her.
Over the next 4 days, Jewel left notes on Dottie's car, asking her to contact him. He wrote of his love and pleaded with her to come home.
I spoke to Jewel, and Jewel told me that he hadn't seen her for 3 or 4 days, and that her car was there, her purse was there, and he didn't know where she was.
Jewel waited 5 days to file a missing persons report with the BART police. They in turn notified the Concord Police Department. 2 weeks later, Jewel moved to Salt Lake City, where he still lives and works.
It was hell living with Dottie. It was hell having her disappear the way that she did. And yet, since I've gotten here and gotten settled and into a new job, that whole problem is behind me. Things are really pretty good.
The Concord Police Department is still investigating Dottie's disappearance, treating the case as a homicide. Police do not consider Jewel Taylor a suspect, but a person of interest. If you have any information about Dottie Caylor, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. next, a young Marine's death is ruled a suicide. His parents are convinced that he was murdered. San Diego, California. Jeffrey Digman's life seemed to be on track. He had become a Marine captain and was stationed near his hometown. He even bought a house with a fellow officer. But only 4 months after his promotion, Jeffrey was transferred to Puerto Rico. According to his friends, Jeffrey was unhappy about the transfer. But by Christmas, he was finally settling in and dating Lucy Garcia, an accountant at the local base.
Jeffrey was a very quiet person. He was so serious, and I liked that of him. He said he was gonna take 2 weeks off to go back home and fix some things.
After Christmas, Jeffrey flew home. He was scheduled to return back to Puerto Rico on Super Bowl Sunday. That day, a neighbor saw Jeffrey at his house. Several hours later, neighbors heard what they thought was a car backfiring. Later that night, when Jeffrey's roommate arrived home with his girlfriend, they were surprised to see that Jeffrey's car was still there. He should have left for Puerto Rico hours before.
When the roommate returned home with his girlfriend, the lights were on, the garage door was open apparently. So this caused some concern, some suspicion, as Mr. Digman was not supposed to be there.
Hi, Bill. I'm sorry to bother you. I was wondering.
The roommate and the girlfriend went across the street to get some neighbors.
They found Jeffrey Digman dead, with a single bullet wound to his right temple. An autopsy revealed that Jeffrey's blood alcohol level was 3 times the legal limit. Traces of gunpowder were found on his right hand, evidence that he had fired a pistol. Jeffrey's death was ruled a suicide.
I had no time ever believed that he committed suicide. I never believed that from when I first got the phone call to when I went down that night. I've always believed that he was murdered, and that's what the evidence shows.
The Naval Investigative Service backed up the coroner's ruling of suicide. Bill and Donna Digman were unconvinced. They began their own investigation, and they would soon find compelling evidence that their son might have been murdered. In Jeffrey's childhood bedroom, the Digmans carefully duplicated the scene of his death.
In this room, we've recreated a mock-up of the crime scene.
With the help of a private investigator, Bill Digman demonstrated why he believes that his son could not have possibly killed himself.
So the first thing I had to do was determine the trajectory of the bullet, which I did. And this is the trajectory of the bullet on that occasion.
This was the position that my son was found in. And for him to have been able to have shot through the head, he had to be shot somewhere along the bullet path here, which means that I have to get lined up with it. And to do that, I have to get in this contorted position. The other thing was that he was left-handed. And if he'd held the gun in his hand and in this contorted position over on the side of the bed, as soon as he was shot, he would have fallen to the floor.
Jeffrey's parents were puzzled by a trail of blood that ran down Jeffrey's left cheek from his ear. This indicated that he was in an upright position for at least 7 seconds after the gunshot. Above Jeffrey's head, on the turned back sheet, was an unexplained smear of blood. His parents hired Steve Schliebe, an independent forensic expert to review the case.
I don't feel that Jeffrey killed himself. I think there was some kind of a struggle that took place and he was shot during that struggle.
Almost a year after Jeffrey's death, his parents requested a second autopsy. Two contusions were found that had not previously been reported. This discovery may support the theory that Jeffrey had been involved in a struggle before his death. But the medical examiner concluded these injuries were insignificant. There was no medical evidence to support a conclusion of homicide. The Digmans remained convinced that their son was murdered. They felt his death was somehow related to his work with the San Diego Marine Drug Testing Unit. Before he'd been transferred to Puerto Rico, Jeffrey served as the drug unit's commanding officer.
People were dealing drugs. People were testing positive. He would write his reports documenting what the results of his investigation were. And those people weren't being disciplined. They were not being discharged. And he was very upset over that.
During the time Jeffrey ran the drug unit, his mother discovered a safe hidden in his room.
I found some military documents in his safe, and I asked him, what were those documents? And that was when he told me that he was saving those tests from drug abuse tests. When we came back to move Jeffrey's things, we wanted to empty the desk to make it lighter. And we opened the hinged door that the safe was usually behind. And the hinged door came off in our hands, and the hinges were not connected. And the safe was not there.
There is another puzzling aspect to this case. When Lucy helped the Marines pack Jeffrey's belongings in Puerto Rico, she found a small green diary of Jeffrey's. When she gave it to the Marines, all its pages were intact. But when they returned it, some pages were missing.
Eventually, we unpacked things and looked for the little green book that Lucy was telling us about. And when we found it, what we found was that the pages were cut out of it.
We want to know why our son is dead. We want to know why. And we're not going to give up until we find out why.
The Armed Forces Institute of Pathology reviewed both autopsy reports. They changed the cause of death to undetermined. But both the Naval Investigative Service and the Riverside County Sheriff's Department stand by their ruling of suicide. If you have any information regarding this case, please contact us at unsolved.com. Next, alert viewers put this con man out of business. And later, we ask for your help to find the arsonist who burned down the church of NFL superstar Reggie White. Medford, Oregon. In an earlier program, we told you about a fugitive by the name of Stephen Cox. Cox formed an investment company that offered clients a 25% return on their money. Many people in Medford invested their life savings, totaling $3.5 million. When the business began to fail, Stephen Cox vanished and so did over $200,000 in valuables. Update. Minutes after the story aired, six viewers called to report that Cox was living in Boise, Idaho, under the assumed name Robert Bradley Davis. It turned out that just hours before the broadcast, Cox disappeared again, telling his wife he was going to Hawaii. But Cox was actually hiding out in a motel 25 miles southeast of Las Vegas, Nevada. He was using the name John Strauss.
He was not the normal guest. He stayed in his room all day long. He would only leave at night. Very seldom did he leave in the daytime. And we noticed that the license plates were not the same as he had put down on his registration card. And that made us a little suspicious, but yet nothing we could put a finger on.
2 weeks later, Edna Reed found the key clue while collecting trash from Cox's room.
And when I went to empty the trash out of that bin, I found the crumpled up letter. And like any curious female, I read the letter. I saw the part that said something about the Unsolved Mystery Show being a bombshell. I showed the letter to my husband, and between the two of us, we decided it was time definitely to call the Rangers and tell them about the guests.
Lake Mead Park Rangers immediately ran a computer check. The car belonged to someone other than John Strauss. The next morning, park rangers spotted Cox's car, and they pulled him over in the parking lot of the Gold Strike Casino.
After we made the traffic stop, he produced identification, a driver's license issued to a Robert Davis. And we checked that name and date of birth through the NCIC computer and found that it was an alias used by one Stephen Cox and that there was a warrant for Mr. Cox. At that point, we placed him under arrest.
When they searched his car, the Rangers uncovered a small fortune.
When we looked in the passenger compartment of the vehicle and in the trunk, we found suitcases and other luggage-type bags filled with jewelry, rings, necklaces, collector-type baseball cards, some gold coins, silver coins.
Stephen Cox was sentenced to 20 years in prison for racketeering and fraud. He was paroled after serving 2 years. When a church in Knoxville, Tennessee was destroyed by arson, it became a major story. It was linked to a series of hate crimes. Its pastor was none other than football legend Reggie White. An NFL Hall of Fame defensive end, Reggie White was credited with sacking more quarterbacks than any other player in history. But this ferocious hitter had a gentle side.
God sent Moses away for about 40 years to get him ready to face Pharaoh.
Reggie White was an ordained minister. In football's offseason, he could be found saving souls in his hometown. Knoxville, Tennessee. Reggie White and two longtime friends found that the inner city church, by merging two congregations into one, their goal was to create a church that would serve poor people of all races. Their motto, together we can make a change.
It's very important and it's very vital. I believe that our church is doing things in our communities that no other churches aren't doing.
Blacks go to black churches, white goes to white churches. We wanted to try to have a church that everybody would feel welcome, no matter what the color was.
It was a noble undertaking that unexpectedly became the target of arsonists.
I believe in my heart that it was an attack from the devil himself, that there were devil-inspired people that he used to firebomb our church.
Agents from the FBI and the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms began to investigate.
An immediate visit to this location indicated to us that it was a very deliberate criminal act. The sanctuary portion of the building had been totally destroyed. They found multiple Molotov cocktails. They found that both floors of this structure had been saturated with gasoline and kerosene. And they found gasoline cans and kerosene cans scattered throughout this portion of the building.
Agents also found racial epithets scrawled on the walls, leaving little doubt that the arson was a hate crime. Reggie White was appalled and then outraged when he learned that his church had not been the first to be torched.
The only reason that you're hearing about my church is because of me. But there have been 22 other churches that's been firebombed. And that's a problem. And this problem needs to be rectified.
At final count, at least 24 black churches were hit by arsonists. The attacks occurred throughout the South.
I don't believe it was anyone that would be what you would call a professional. Based on the way the fuel was in the building, the way the setups were in the building, I think that they just thought if a little's good, a whole lot's better. And that's what they tried to do, is put enough fuel in there to do the job.
The inner city church in Knoxville did not have enough fire insurance to cover all the damages. But with hard work from the parishioners and donations from the community, both black and white, they hoped to rebuild.
But the problem is, because racism has alienated itself so that you can't touch it, when it afflicts
Reggie White and his fellow pastors kept the spirit of their congregation strong with church services held at a local school auditorium.
That's why we're shooting each other today. That's why we're alive. This just makes me more determined. And I know that the only way that you defeat the devil is that you have to do it as a group. And that's why I would call whites and blacks to come together and find how to work together, because what kills the enemy's tactics is if a bunch of people of all ethnic backgrounds start loving each other.
Sadly, Reggie White died of sudden heart failure 8 years after the fire. His church has yet to be rebuilt. The arson investigation remains open. If you have any information about this case or any of the others we profiled, please log on to unsolved.com.